Hey guys, I made it through. You know, I kept thinking I'm going to play all the way through past the bridge, and I'm going to do it. So this today, this is a celebration of Steve Lukather. And when I first moved to LA in 1980, Steve was very, very busy doing all the records. Toto was already established. So Toto started in 1977. This song was recorded in 1982. And I guarantee you, Steve showed up, looked at a chart, and played this right off the top of his head, because that's how it worked. And that's kind of amazing to me. Hey, Rhett, how are you, man? Rhett Scholl. Go see Rhett's channel if you haven't already. So Steve, the amazing thing about Steve is that not only was he full-time in Toto, and they were hugely successful at that point, he was still doing his day job, which was showing up on a daily basis for huge artists and playing great guitar parts on the spot, on the floor, off the floor. So that's what blows me away about this. This is something, you know, it was a tracking date, and I haven't talked to him. I haven't talked to Greg Phil and Gaines. He was the keyboard player. But this was probably done in less than three takes, if I had to guess. It was just probably instant. And so it was Steve Lukather on guitar, Lewis Johnson on bass, Jeff Porcaro on drums, Michael McDonald on keyboards, and Greg Phil and Gaines on keyboards. I've had the opportunity to work with several of those people. I even did something with Michael McDonald once. He was super, super nice. Why it's important to me, Steve Lukather actually is kind of a big part of my DNA as a rhythm guitar player. I don't know where he learned his rhythm guitar style, but for me as a rhythm player playing R&B, clean R&B, fitting, comping in a track, this is what formed me, listening to him play. Because when I moved to LA in the 80s, it was on the job training for me. I could play lead quite a bit, but I learned to play rhythm on the job. And it was guys like him and Michael Landau, Paul Jackson Jr., David Williams. These are the guys who were doing it, and this is how I learned. So my rhythm style in this regard is basically influenced by Steve Lukather. I mean, he kind of taught me how to do this, and I emulate him still to this day. So it's a really great thing. I'm just going to show you a couple of things about this, and then we'll do some questions and answers. Also, there is a special offer on the Masterclass. There's a link right below this video that'll be good for this weekend. If you want to, you know, take us up on a special offer on the Masterclass, it's right there. Oh, Rick Beato. Thanks for joining. Oh, man. This is such a high-octane thing. These are filled with adrenaline. I don't know if you guys know, but when you actually do this live in front of hundreds and thousands of people, it's pretty exciting. It's pretty, but yeah, you're filled with adrenaline. So no tequila for me before this. So I feel it all. Anyway, Lukather, on a situation like this, basically, very quickly, I'm just going to show you a little bit of what's amazing about this guitar part. So he's muting, right? And it's call and response. So if you count the bars, the first three bars are a part that's familiar, that's repeating. And the audience and the listener loves repetition. So as a guitar player, never, never deny yourself repetition. So the first part of this is something that repeats, and that's great for you and great for the listener and the audience. And then comes what I call the corner, where he does the variation. And this is great for the listener also, because you use repetition and you carry that, and then the variation happens, and you take a risk, and the audience hears something new, and then you go back to repetition. So the recovery is really important too. So I've found over the last few days playing this that if I do my variation up here, it's actually a better variation. I'll show you what I mean. And then I come back down and I start muting. Now I also open up the variation. That's another thing I want to stress here, is that this is a muted part. Steve does open it up for this, the variation within the repetition, but that's repeated too. And that's tricky. I don't always get that. I'm muting here, and then when I open up my hand to get, it's still tricky, and I've done it a lot. I've rehearsed it a lot, and I've prepared it a lot. So the verse is one thing. And because I've taken the vocal out, you know, this track has no vocal, I'm able to play more than Steve did on the date, but Steve's part is very simple, and that's because the point of this whole thing is the pocket, the other musicians, and primarily Michael McDonald's vocal. So when you're in service of that all the time. So Steve's variations are very minimal. They're very thrown away. It might be something like that. He does that on the vamp. So because there's no vocal, I'm able to kind of floor it with the variations here and do them busier. Now, the thing that really blows me away about this is Steve's part in the chorus. And it might not be for the reasons that you think. It's actually the simplest thing he could have thought of. Okay? So he's playing in the verse. And then when it comes to the chorus, he plays one note. With a variation. One note in the chorus. It's basically reggae on one note. And guys, that's brilliant. To have all his firepower, when you see Steve Lukather on stage, you're only seeing the tip of the iceberg or in any recording situation. So he's playing crazy rock solos, right? And he's singing lead and he's written the songs. And there's songs he's written that are hits that he's written on piano. So I'm talking about the tip of the iceberg with him. So in a situation like this, and Steve can be Larry Carlton on demand too. Put him in that situation, I've heard him do it. He can basically become Larry because that's one of his biggest influences. So put Steve in the studio with all that firepower and all that knowledge and all that talent, and he decides that the right thing to do in the chorus is this. That's brilliant. That's what studio musicians are amazing at. It's being in service of the song and the singer. I mean, it actually even gives me chills to talk about it this way. You have this guy who can do anything on the planet musically, and he chooses to do this. That is making music. And when I first moved here, that's what would blow me away about these guys is the taste and the choices. The simple choices they would make in service of the song. That way everybody else can move around, you know? And then he kind of takes the verse. The verse, he kind of owns the verse in this song. But in the chorus, he renounces his ownership and becomes a guy who plays reggae on one note. So let me just go through one cycle of this now that I've talked about it for a while and kind of demonstrate it because it's just super fun to play. You heard him. So that's brilliant. And that's just the tip of the iceberg with Steve. Okay, so before we do question and answer, I just want to do one more thing that's really important. Because you got to realize that Steve was doing this. This was his day job. And one other track like this that's a World Series home run that he did just off the top of his head is Human Nature by Michael Jackson. I'm just going to play a little bit of that, not much of it, but I can't show this rhythm style and this rhythm prowess without showing this song too, because it's this is one of my favorite guitar parts in history. Okay, let me just get this right in Pro Tools. Unmute that. Okay, so I checked this out, and there, when you listen to the record, you're tempted to think that the guitar is doing this. Because there's a keyboard in there that's creating this, you know, 3-4 thing. But I found an amazing performance by Toto in 2012 in Henderson, Nevada, and I've watched Steve play this song, and he's doing it the easy way. He's kind of just laughing and walking around the stage, and this is where he plays it. Once again, all this firepower just put on pause so he can play this beautiful part and kind of walk around the stage and smile at his bandmates. Joseph Williams is singing it amazing. You gotta check it out. 2012, Henderson, Nevada. Human Touch. Toto. So I couldn't do I Keep Forgetting by Michael McDonald without doing Human Nature also, because I was about to say Human Touch. Rick Springfield had a song called Human Touch. Human Nature is another World Series home run Steve Lukather, the guitar part that he just did while he was balancing his day job as in service of huge artists going to studios in LA with being in Toto full time too. So, you know, it's just the tip of the iceberg. And these parts actually formed the way I play. And I'll tell you, the real challenge with something like this is alternating muted parts with open parts. Because if you're muting, and then you open up, there's a recovery that happens each time you change that, and it has to be exactly right. So that's something that still eludes me sometimes. So we always are learning and always trying to improve. So anyway, guys, there is a link if you want to try this special offer in the masterclass. It's a 14-day free trial. I get a lot of questions about the masterclass. I just got one where one of you asked if there are backing tracks in the masterclass. And yes, there are. But more than that, the reason we do a 14-day free trial is so that you can answer every question you've ever had and then decide to opt out. So please, you know, just know that if you want to check it out, you can opt out. And yeah, there are tons of backing tracks. That's one of my favorite things in the world, is to make backing tracks. So there's a special offer that'll be good this weekend if you want to check it out. So I'm going to actually maybe mute this, and it'll be a little quieter, and I can take some questions and kind of interact with you guys. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Thanks, Rick. Thanks, Rhett. And I'll play again, too. In fact, let me just open up the I Keep Forgetting track, too, and that way I can be ready. Yeah, you're calling it simple to childlike guitar parts. Yeah, that's the job. I mean, it's like if you're making music, everything's in service of the piece of music that you're working on. And a lot of us as guitar players get obsessed with stuff that's outside that realm. So, yeah. Yeah, thanks, guys. Yeah, the late beginner part in the masterclass is something that we're going to keep expanding, you know. It'll take some time, but I'm always adding to that part because I want to get more of you that are on the early side of your guitar journey. Can you show us some of your favorite chord voicings? I'll show you a couple. E minor 9. Oh. I like it up here. I like this. Right. I like it. I like A minor 9 here. This is kind of the angel chord. Here's something that really I can answer your question well. My favorite chord voicings are polychords slash chords, which means you just take a regular chord and you change the bass note. So here's a C, C triad, put F in the bass. C over F, that creates a F major 9. So my advice to you, if you want to find my favorite chord voicings, just take a triad anywhere and find a different bass note. Oh man, you know, it's just like, I mean, just do this. Take an E chord, stretch your hand, put A in the bass, it's E over A. I mean, what's not to like? Yeah, dude, do polychords. Let's see what else. Oh, David, that's a great question. When you do a solo, do you finish a phrase in the same position as where you started, or is that a principle for you to change position during every phrase? Both. The answer is true both ways, and I've actually thought about that this week. So there are two things you need to do. You need to squeeze the most out of five notes in one position, and I'll demonstrate that. Can also be. So all of those were just recombining five notes. You need to be able to do that. You need to be able to stay in one spot and recombine. Let's choose five notes. You can even do it with three, but five's a little easier. Recombine. In every way you can possibly think of those five notes. And then for excitement, I'm constantly changing positions in the middle of a phrase. And that means I'm usually leading up the neck with my third finger or my little finger, or down the neck with my index finger in the middle of a phrase. I will demonstrate that. Okay, I'm in a new position. Here we go again. And again. And again. Now I'll go down. So the idea is, if your eyes are closed, you don't know where I'm moving positions. And to answer your question completely, fully, to close the circle, there's a lot of excitement in every time you move. And in fact, I just demonstrated that in my part on this song. I found that when I play the regular part here and do the variation up here, I like the variations better than when I stay down here. Now, if Michael McDonald was singing the song, I would probably stay down here because I'd be really sensitive to everything he's singing and never overshadowing him. So the game changes depending on, you know, what the context is, what the arena is, what the venue is, what stage you're on. Well, guys, we're about at the end of our my time limit here. I have some stuff to do. So I want to thank you all for being here. I wanted this to be about Steve Lukather, and it's one thing I'll say about him also is that I believe he's playing better than he ever has at this moment in time, because he's mellowed a little bit. And I have, when I see him, you know, because just like all of us, he's been home, so there's a lot of YouTube stuff of him at home, and I saw something recently of him at home. The way his hands touch the guitar, it's my favorite. It's just like my favorite touch. It's like there's an economy of motion. When you see him play these parts, it's like he's barely doing anything. No waste